Today we are going to discuss about the high flow nasal oxygen therapy. It is also very old, but it is very much fond of trend is increasing towards the COVID-19 respiratory failure patients. And we are having this machine in our Theri Medical College Hospital, 3 in number. We are having the experience of this HFNOT in COVID-19 patients with the type and respiratory failure, having really very good results, and we can avoid intubation, early intubation, and early aerosolization of...
Kannan, sorry to interrupt. You can mute.
Mute all. Now it is muted to all. Now it is muted to all. Next, next. And this is the machine we are having this in a COVID-19 ward. And we are going to discuss about this machine also and this mechanism, physiology, and how it helps in respiratory failure and all. We are going to discuss about it in the later slides. And before going to this, program not having only anesthetists and all categories of doctors are involved. So we have gone to the terminologies, which are all new to the other doctors are concerned. First is the FiO2. That we have to know about it. That is fractional inspired oxygen concentration. The concentration of oxygen delivered to the patient. Suppose we are having the breath of room air, that is atmospheric air, having 21%, the FiO2 is 21%. In a patient with COVID respiratory failure, this concentration is not enough, and we need further oxygen devices to overcome this reduction in saturation. And next one is the PaO2, that is terminology. This capital A stands for alveoli. So alveolar oxygen tension, that is PaO2. And next terminology, P small AO2, that is arterial partial pressure of oxygen, oxygen tension in the arteries. And that is the gradient between this alveoli and the artery. That is the most important point. More the gradient, there is a more the hypoxemia. Less gradient, less the hypoxemia. And that next one is the PaCO2, small A stands for artery, and CO2 tension in the artery. That we can have it this and percentage in end-tidal CO2 concentration also. These are all the terminologies. We have to remember it before using this machine. Okay, thank you. And next that, we have to know about these terminologies also, oxygenation failure, and next is the ventilation failure. And what do you mean by oxygenation failure? In COVID patients, mostly it is an oxygenation failure, and there is no ventilation failure. What do you mean by oxygenation failure? That is the failure of the lungs and heart to provide adequate oxygen to meet out our demands. And even with the higher concentration of oxygen delivered to the patient, that is PO2 level is normally it is 97 to 100 millimeter of mercury. And even with the higher the concentration of 0.5, they're not able to maintain the PaO2 level. That is the arterial oxygen tension is not maintained, and it is less than 60, we can label this patient as hypoxemic respiratory failure. Even the PaO2 is less than 40, even the FiO2 is more than any FiO2. Or simply by our pulse oximetry, if the saturation is less than 90 and less, we can call this patient as patient is having respiratory failure due to hypoxemic oxygen. And our next one is the ventilation failure. When I talk about the term vent, that denotes always CO2 elimination. And CO2 elimination is ventilation. It is not eliminated properly. That condition is called ventilation failure. And we can have the criteria of, we can measure the CO2 level by ABG machine. If it is more than 50, we can definitely label this patient as hypercorbia, that is hypercorbic ventilatory failure, or simply you can call it as ventilation failure. And this type of patient needs invasive ventilation. But oxygenation failure is not like this. We can go into the detail later. And simply, for we are talking about this oxygenation failure by simple formula, without doing any ABG, we can identify it by SpO2 by FiO2 ratio. That should be more than 3.15. Suppose we are having, I am having this SpO2 level of 98%, and I am breathing the atmospheric air of 21%, and the value is 466. I am normal person. I am normal breathing atmospheric air. Suppose the same thing, the patient shows 95% SpO2 level. With the FiO2, we are giving a 50% oxygen concentration, we are giving 0.5. It is 150, 190, patient is having mild hypoxemic respiratory failure. Suppose the patient having 90% with the FiO2 of 80%, it is 1112. We can label this patient as moderate hypoxemic failure. It is a very simple thing. The patient having 89% with 100% oxygen we are giving, and the value is 89, you can label this patient as severe hypoxemic respiratory failure. This is for our simple calculation. Without using this ABG level, we can identify what is the grade on level of the respiratory failure. And these are all, for this, it is the original thing, oxygenation index and saturation index and PaO2, FiO2, all these needs ABG values. And MAP, that is the mean airway pressure, we can calculate it by the ventilator. So I don't want to go into these details. And the previous slide, this is enough for identifying what is the grading of respiratory failure. Simply with this non-invasively, we can measure it. And this is the pathophysiology. I don't want to go into the details in detail because the inhaled the inhaled infected virus in the infected lungs and virus detection and got into the macrophages. Macrophages produce excessive of interleukin-6 and pro-inflammatory interleukins that are all released, and that recruits the T helper cells and further amplify the inflammatory cytokines, ultimately leading on to death of these lymphocytes, lead on to lymphopenia. That patient having lymphopenia, that denotes that the patient having very high viral load, and the patient is going for inflammation to hyperinflammation state. Next. And this excessive cytokines make the blood vessels hyperpermeable, lead down to leaking, and stimulates the coagulation cascade, and edema all lead to destruction, and ultimately lead down to cytokine storage and death of the patient. And so in this, there is an oxygenation failure, that is the hypoxemic failure, and there is a lung to capillary cutoff and capillary to tissues, that is by the heart, that is due to hypotension caused by this hypoxemia. So that is purely that simple diagram, schematic diagram shows that hypoxemic respiratory failure of the lungs to meet the metabolic demands of our tissues. So in this situation, we can have a very glance regarding this the oxygen delivery devices which are all available, and then we can go for HFNO. The simple device, that is a nasal cannula. Yes, everybody knows about it. It delivers the fractional inspiratory oxygen concentration of 24 to 30%, and the flow rate of 1 to 4 liter per minute. It is used in non-acute situations. Everybody will know about it. But the FiO2 delivered by this instrument is 24 to 30%. That is the thing you have to remember. And next is the Huston mask. That is the oxygen mask or ordinary PVC mask, which delivers the FiO2 of 30 to 40%. What is the disturbance? And with a flow rate of 5 to 10 liters per minute. It is the next commonly used in the wards. And next is the Venturi mask. It is a special device having color coded. So many colors are available. Each color coded the device that will produce certain percentage of FiO2 in a fixed concentration by this Bernoulli's principle. If you use this blue device, it will give the FiO2 of 24%. If you use this white device, FiO2 of 28%. If you use yellow device, it is 3% of FiO2. Red device is then FiO2 of 40%. And green device having this FiO2 of 60%. Mostly, what happens? It maximum this device can deliver the FiO2 of 24 to 60% maximum. Almost all are instructed to mute the radio. All the participants, please mute the radio, please. It is disturbing. Almost all the participants are requested to mute the radios, please. And next one device is non-breather mask. This is the device. It can deliver FiO2 of 75 to 90% because of this reservoir which contains oxygen with the maximum flow rate of 15 liter per minute. We can use it. What is it? And background mask with the valves. It is usually you can give this higher the FiO2 concentration with this using this device. And next one is a CPAP, that is an NIV mask, commonly we can say it, with this tight-fitting mask. It will produce continuous positive pressure, both phases of respiration, both inspiration and expiration, and positive pressure is maintained inside the airway. And there is a high-pressure air-oxygen mixture with a tight-fitting mask. And there is a positive pressure all the time. It is a very discomfort to the patient, and the patient cannot swallow, eat anything else. And it can be used in acute respiratory failure, hypoxemic, and also in mild case of pulmonary edema. And usually this type of CPAP mask are used in sleep apnea syndrome with obese patient. They can use this CPAP in the home also. And next one is the non-invasive ventilation, which we are all know it needs ICU setup. And we need ventilators, costly ventilators, and it is very costly, and it needs exports needed to manage these patients. But one thing is, we can give 100% oxygen, and it can be used only in intensive care and theaters also. And coming to this proper, the HFNO machine. And we are having this machine like this. I have already shown the first slide. It is having this flow meter, and it's the nasal interface, and there is a humidifier, and instead of tubing is there. And you can use this in the wards also, and also in the critical care units also. It doesn't need any special persons are needed to operate this machine.
Excuse me, sir.
Used only by the staff.
Dr. Kannan, sir, please can you hear me?
The triad of available triad of humidity,
Dr. Kannan, sir,
high FiO2, and the patient compliance is good. These are the three important points I want to stress about it.
Dr. Kannan, sir,
regarding this specialty of this machine is concerned. And this can give this machine as a high flow rate of 10 to 70 liters of oxygen, we can able to give it. And we can give humidified oxygen to the patient. Humidified oxygen. Yes. So, what is this? Can you able to see the slides?
Yes, sir.
Now it is okay?
No, yeah. We are able to see the slide.
Ah, okay. We can have this. I have already told this triad.
Dr. Kannan sir, can you hear me, please?
This high flow rate from 10 liters to 70 liters per minute. And we can give the oxygen or gas at the normal body temperature of 37 degree. There's a heated humidifier is available in this machine. And that is the humidification of the air as per the physiology of our body. And we can increase the FiO2 from room FiO2 of room 21% to maximum of 100%. And the patient compliance is very good and very comfort. And this is this machine. I can see the flow meter here, starting from this 10 liter up to 70 liter. And we are having these pots in this machine, having this flow meter I have already told. There is an air oxygen blender is present that mixes the oxygen and air in this machine. And there is a water reservoir is in the upper pot that will supply continuous of water to this humidifier. For humidification, and this humidifier having the heating system. There will the heating system normally in our anesthesia machine, there is a heated humidifier is usually not available, and in our any other oxygen devices, the heated humidifier is not available, and we can having the humidifier of room temperature of 20 degree, and that will produce so much of adverse effect, which will I will tell you in later. What happens if you use this humidifier at the temperature of 20 degrees centigrade? And where this is the nasal interface with the nasal cannula, and the air is coming, the gas, blender gas is coming through this heated non-condensing circuit, and the water will not be condensed through this circuit. This is a specialized circuit. These are all the parts of this machine. You can use this. It's a wide bore nasal cannula is present in this machine to prevent jetting. The jetting will be very discomfort to the patient because we are using this in a very high flow. This jetting can be minimized by this wide bore nasal cannula. And this is an nasal interface. We can tightly fit this into the patient's head. And with these advantages, with this nasal interface, with this HFNO machine, the patient can able to drink, and the patient can able to read, and patient can able to say something, talk to the neighbors, and all, it is all possible. It is a small video. I am playing this video, this machine, having this plate, heated plate, and the stand is there. The oxygen source connected to the blender, and this is an humidifier with inflow and outflow water chamber, having this water chamber humidifier inside. This is a circuit connected to the outer circuit, non-condensing this circuit with a patient interface, and we can have this adult and pediatric nasal cannula. Is the junior nasal cannula is available for the pediatric population, and we can use this the tracheostomy interface also. Patient on tracheostomy, we can use this machine. As a mask, you can use this mask interface is there. There are so many interfaces. There's a mobile cold stand for stability of the instrument. We can easily transportable from one place to other place, one bed to another bed, and here is the blender. Air is blending in and oxygen is coming in. Both are mixed, and turbine inside the machine that is blending of air and oxygen to provide adequate needed FiO2 that is delivered to the patient. Okay, then we'll stop the video. And from this, and this heated humidifier at the water at the temperature of 37 degrees centigrade, and with this water vapor of 47 millimeter of mercury that is delivered outside into the non-condensing heated circuit. Okay, there is a small video regarding this. What I have told about blending, that is an oxygen and air blending. If you increase the flow, that is the flow, oxygen flow to the machine, not the patient. If you increase in the flow, blending is very less with the air and higher the FiO2 can be delivered. If you reduce the flow, more air, more blending, and reduce the FiO2 delivered according to the patient need. Suppose if you put this patient on 15 liter per minute for the machine and you are setting the patient's flow rate of 40 liter per minute, the oxygen is 15 liter, total air delivered is 40 liter, air blending is 25 liter, 15 by 25, that is 0.33, 33% of FiO2 delivered to the patient. Okay. The same time, if you are using this 15 liter, there is no air blending, you can set the flow rate to the patient of 15 liter, you can give you the FiO2 of 0.981, 100% FiO2 can be delivered to the patient. Okay. We can set like this in this machine. Suppose if you are machine oxygen flow 20 liter per minute, 100% oxygen, and flow rate to the patient was set to 50 liter, and what is the FiO2 delivered? 20 by 50 is 0.4, 40% of FiO2 delivered to the patient. So we can, for adjusting the oxygen flow to the machine, we can alter the FiO2 delivered to the patient. Okay, thank you. And then there is the blending which I already told. And we talk about the physiology of this HFNO. And I am talking about so much regarding this humidification is concerned. What does it do if the humidification is not adequate? And air is warmed and humidified at the body temperature. And the viscosity of the tracheobronchial secretions are reduced. It can be easily cleared. If it is very dry, what happens? The secretion will become thick and tenacious and it will not be cleared out and it will be piled up in the tracheobronchial tree and there is a stasis, an infection, airway obstruction, atelectasis, all will occur. So this viscosity, I mean the humidified air at body temperature, that enhances the mucociliary clearance and reduces the dryness of the upper airway, thereby improving the patient comfort. The comfort of the patient, the dry air getting inside the tracheobronchial tree is very irritating to the tracheobronchial tree. If you do like this, when you have this experience of it, you can have it. You know it. So dry air cannot be insufflated into the tracheobronchial tree. It will be a very discomfort and the patient compliance is very, very bad. So mucosal clearance is very good. And this prevents the desiccation of the airway epithelium. And next one is this, the constant fraction of inspired oxygen concentration FiO2 is delivered because here, see what this patient is not blended with this machine. We are setting this ordinary device with a rate of 10 liter per minute. And what happens to the rest? The patient, we are having this peak inspiratory flow of 40 liter per minute for the patient, or for the adult is concerned. We are able to provide only this 10 liters in ordinary flow meter. And next rest of the air, 30 liter per second, that is entrained from the atmosphere. That is this thing, what is in the dotted line, what I am saying. But if you use this OptiFlow machine, there cannot be any entrainment of air. The machine can adequately give the peak inspiratory flow. That is demand by the patient. And whatever present in the tracheobronchial tree is fully oxygen. Nothing else. So it minimizes the oxygen dilution with the room air. The delivered FiO2 corresponds slowly to the set FiO2. And there is a reduction of work of breathing. Yes, if a normal breathing is concerned, see the physiology. In the normal breathing, you have to generate the negative pressure. to suck the air from the atmosphere. See, with the zero point during inspiration, you have to generate the negative pressure by using this inspiratory muscles are concerned, and this negative pressure, negative transpulmonary pressure, suck the air from the atmosphere, and during expiration is the positive pressure and air is pulled out. The quality of the negative pressure is sucking, so thereby you are sucking. There is a normal physiology of our respiratory mechanics, but in this case we are producing high flow of nasal oxygen that will generate positive pressure in both phases of respiration. See, during inspiration and also during expiration, and we need not have to generate the negative pressure, and much work is not needed by the respiratory muscles. Thereby can reduce the work of breathing, and thereby it reduces the resistance offered by the upper airway, because during negative pressure the upper airway collapses, and during the next during expiration the upper airway dilates approximately, and every time we have the airway resistance in the upper airway, we have to overcome it, the collapsed upper airway, during every respiratory efforts. That is not needed. That is not needed in this using this machine, because we are maintaining this positive pressure in both phases of inspiration and expiration, and we can increase the alveolar ventilation also. So the alveolar ventilation means the terminology is meaning of this terminology is the part of the minute ventilation that takes part in the oxygen exchange, gas exchange. Minute ventilation is respiratory rate into tidal volume. All the tidal volume will not be come in part to the alveolar ventilation because of the anatomical dead space from nose to the terminal alveoli. There is no gases partaking in the gases exchange, and that is called a dead space ventilation. And in this, the alveolar ventilation is increased by means of the almost all the alveoli inside the lung is fully filled with oxygen that takes part in the gaseous exchange, thereby increasing the alveolar ventilation. And pharyngeal dead space was out, as I already told earlier. The high flow generates a reservoir of oxygen that minimizes the CO2 rebreathing, because whatever the gas inside the airway from the nose to the respiratory bronchial, almost all are filled with a high flow of oxygen, and CO2 is expelled out. And this, whatever the CO2 present inside during expiration, the next act of inspiration, we are rebreathing whatever it is inside the tracheobronchial tree that can be avoided. So reduces the dead space and increase the alveolar ventilation over the minute ventilation. And this peak effect, I already told. We are maintaining the positive pressure. I have already told about this and both phases. So this machine, how to use it? Use this machine. What are the uses of this machine? In what are the situations we can use this machine? The first and foremost one is hypoxemic acute respiratory failure. You can use this machine. It will provide FiO2 with a metabolic demands as the fixed value, and we can use this in a post exhibition respiratory failure, and we can use this in a very mild and moderate cases of cardiogenic pulmonary edema. And there is a post operative ward, immediate hypoxemia occurs, and we need not have to look for the doctors. Let the staff nurses to give put the machine on the patient with a high flow of 20 liters per minute. We can overcome this hypoxemia, post surgical hypoxemia. And you can use this for anesthetic point of view. During pre-oxygenation and airway management in operation theater, you can use this machine. And pre-oxygenation and rapid seeking intubation in ICU, you can use it. And any oxygen administration in any endoscopic procedures that are all followed. We can use this machine also. For endoscopic procedures with a mild sedation, the patient you have to oxygenate this patient. We can use this in the nasal prong, and surgeon can do the endoscopic procedure very leisurely. And whatever the situation, you should not use this machine. Then the most important thing is, I'll take a type 2 respiratory failure. I won't explain it what it is actually. What I am talking about so far else is type 1 respiratory failure, that is hypoxemic respiratory failure. Type 2 respiratory failure is what I have told is ventilatory failure, that is CO2 washout. CO2 elimination is not adequate because patient is not respiring properly. There is no respiratory effort or hypoventilation. That lead on to type 2 respiratory failure. For the physician, for better understanding, the CO2 retention in COPD patients. Never, you cannot use this COPD patient if there is a hypercarbia, high level of hypercarbia. It will aggravate the existing problem. You should not use in ventilatory failure. You can use it in hypoxemic failure. And you cannot use in unconscious patient. Unconscious patient, it cannot use this lead on to aspiration. And the patient is uncooperative? No. Patient having bleeding nose? No. Patient having facial injury? No. Patient having any airway obstruction? No. So airway obstruction, there is a CO2 elimination, there is a ventilatory failure and hypoxemic failure. Both are present in airway obstruction. And the guideline very recently released by our Government of India 27/6/20 yesterday, and they have said that compared to standard oxygen therapy, HFNO reduce the need for intubation. That is the latest guideline released by our Government of India. And next one is safe in patient with mild, moderate and non-worsening hypercapnia. COPD patient not having so much of CO2 retention, having mild hypercarbia, we can use this machine. And endobronchial endotracheal intubation, acute deterioration or does not, you can delay the endobronchial intubation, endotracheal intubation for about 1 hour. You can wait and see. Still it is oxygenation is not improving. By this 70 liter of oxygen with the FiO2 of 100%, you can go for endobronchial intubation, endotracheal intubation. Sorry. So recent publication suggests that newer HFNO on NIV, that is the latest publication released by the Government of India 27/6/20. HFNO NIV systems, that is non-invasive ventilation system with a good interface fitting, do not create widespread dispersion of exhaled air. Therefore, we should be associated with the low risk of airborne transmission. So the aerosolization by this machine is much more minimal because of the very tight fitting nasal interface and with this NIV system. That is the point I want to make it out. And HFNO in COVID, in so many journals so far else, and published from Anesthesia 2020, the use of high flow nasal oxygen in COVID-19 patient, that conclusion shows that this method of respiratory support may reduce the requirement of invasive mechanical ventilation of the patient. It reduces the need for intubation, that is a very dangerous to the healthcare person, especially for the anesthetist concerned. They are more prone for contracting the disease if you intubate the patient, because it is a high level of aerosol generating procedure and the risk is very, very high. And aerosolization, from the critical care journal, prone position combined with HFNO in severe COVID-19 patient, the prone position with HFNO in an awake patient, and the saturation is very good, improving very good, and we can avoid intubation by using this HFNO in a prone position from this journal critical care released from 2020 latest. And next one, high flow nasal oxygen from the Oxford Education Press, that shows there is a triad what I have told earlier, the humidity in the body temperature and very good compliance of the patient and high FiO2 delivered to the patient. That is the most important point. You can give up to 100%. likely to be of use in wide variety of clinical situation. This is a rapidly evolving area, and evidence for this use in acute hypoxemic respiratory failure and in advanced airway management for the anesthetist is concerned, and also in the postoperative population also. Postoperative patients, those who are going for hypoxemia in the immediate postoperative ward and high dependency units. And another article from BJA latest, high flow nasalogen therapy in intensive care and anesthesia, that shows compared with the standard technique, that is the conventional modes of oxygen therapy, the HFNO improves the safety in patients with known or anticipated difficult airways undergoing elective intubation, and it may help in avoiding or limiting hypoxia during invasive diagnostic procedures also. And next one is the New England Journal of Medicine, where HFNO in acute hypoxemic respiratory failure, that shows the conclusion is the patient with non-hypercapnic acute hypoxemic failure, that is a patient having non-ventilatory, there is a significant difference in favor of high flow oxygen and 90-day mortality rate. And next journal from the respiratory care and high flow oxygen therapy in acute respiratory failure, and that journal shows that the conclusion of HFNC is better tolerator and more comfortable than face mask. Patient can able to eat, walk and drink whatever patient needs, patient can say. And it is associated with better oxygenation. And the respiratory rate of the patient is reduced. The hypoxic drive is reduced because we can able to oxygenate the patient very well in a non-invasive manner. And HFNC could have an important role in the treatment of patients with acute respiratory failure. Okay. And another original article from this Thrive, it's an old article. It is published in 2015 from anesthesia. That shows that you can maintain oxygen saturation during difficult intubation for the anesthesiologists are concerned. You can stop hurrying when difficult intubation situation arises. You can use this HFNO. It can increase the safe apnea period. Window period is increased up to 15 minutes. You can leisurely can do next things. We need not have to hurry up. All those things we have to. So suppose the patient can, as the anesthetist is concerned, because other doctors are here, if the patient is not able to intubate, and hurriness will occur, and that lead on to so many complications and catastrophe of the patient also. In those situation, if you put the patient on HFNO with a high flow of 30 to 40 liter per minute, and we can lesser intubate, not able to intubate, don't be panicked. The apneic window is very high, and that is it will be increased up to 15 minutes. We can lesserly act and can save the patient. We can take the other measures to overcome the situation of hypoxemia. And another journal, BJA, released from 2011, is old, and it will increase the end expiratory lung volume. That is, at the end of expiration, the alveoli going to collapse. Alveoli going to collapse. So if you apply positive pressure at that instance, you can prevent alveolar collapse. Thereby you can recruit the alveoli, they can reduce the desaturation, and you can reduce the respiratory rate also. That is the thing, they have the study was done in post cardiac surgical patient where this alveolar collapse is very high in post operative period. It's a very old journal. It is the use of this HFNO machine. In a nutshell, I'm going to say, finish it. It is a humidity at the body temperature. That is the thing you all have to remember it. And the compliance and comfort of the patient is excellent. And we have the experience. With these three missions, we are having this COVID. Our hospital is a COVID, dedicated COVID hospital. You are using this machine. And the patients are compliant and comfort with this machine. And we can able to deliver maximum of 98% of FPO2 so far else. And we cannot able to reach it 100%. So far else, we can able to reach it 5 out of 98% with this machine. And we can use this in ward environment. It doesn't need any ICU setup. Extraordinary setup is not at all needed for it. And when you can use this in mild to moderate case of acute hypoxemic respiratory failure. It's a very good response than conventional oxygen therapy, what I have told in earlier instruments, I have told. conventional instruments, oxygen therapy. Can use this HFNO. The saturation is very better, far better, and improvement in oxygen saturation is very good also with our small experience. And we can increase the safety optic oxygenation time for the anesthetic is concerned. We cannot able to intubate. We can buy time. And regarding this pre-oxygenation and rapid sequence induction, you can use this HFNO. And very mild and moderate cases of acute pulmonary edema. If nobody is there in the situation, nobody able to intubate this pulmonary edema, you can use this HFNO with a high flow rate of 50 liter per minute. It will overcome the situation till the time arise the doctor comes and intubate. You can buy time for it. And in acute post-operative wards, immediate post-operative wards, there is an extubation, post-extubation respiratory failure. It will very well be used. Thank you very much for your nice patient audience.